Praise the Lord, praise Jesus, praise the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I'm from the Rock Intercessor Ministries. I'm here today to preach to you the word of Jesus Christ, hoping that some of you give your life to God today, amen. Now today's message is the hidden treasure. The hidden treasure. Many people today all over the world are looking for hidden treasure, but those treasures that you are looking for today is the earthly treasure, and they will not last long. You see, in today's message, the hidden treasure, Jesus Christ tells us about the parable hidden, about the hidden treasure. It is a very short parable. It's just one verse. Listen to it. Matthew chapter 13, verse 44. Jesus Christ says, the kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field, which a man found and covered it. And then in his joy, he goes and sells all that he has and buy that field. So in this short parable, I want you to see, the Bible says that here is a man going through the field. As we are walking around today, the Bible says he was going through the field. He finds a treasure in that field. And what he does is quite interesting. He uncovers the treasure, and then he knows that also this land does not belong to him. This field does not belong to him. And the Bible says when he uncovers the treasure, he sells all his assets and he buys that field. So here is, so he has the treasure right now. You see, because if you have the field, you also do what? Have the treasure. So I want you to remind you also that the parable is an earthly story with a heavenly meaning. So what is the interpretation of this parable? What is the meaning of this earthly story that Jesus Christ told us, you see? And I know there's a general conception. I used to be one of them in the past. You kind of interpret this parable in a different way. But today, I know that you have thought the same way as well. Because if I thought the same way, many of us today might have the same mindset, you see? But let me tell you, we were wrong in the past. I was wrong. You are wrong as well. So this treasure, people always say they interpret it in this way. And the people say the treasure is the gospel. The field is the Bible, which is the word of God. And where the gospel is hidden, and the man who finds it is a sinner. And he goes into the world. He goes into find the treasure. And when he finds it, he sells everything that he has to do what? To become a Christian. And of course, this is not the proper interpretation of this parable. And I want you, if you read all the parables, the seven parables Jesus Christ gives in the book of Matthew, Matthew chapter 13, if you look into it, you find out in the book of Matthew chapter 13, verse 38, the Bible says the field is the word. And the man in this parable is not a sinner seeking heaven, but the man in this parables is our Lord Jesus Christ, you see? In verse 37, he answered this, and he said, the one who sowed the good seed is the Son of Man. And that is right, you see. So Jesus Christ is the man, and he's the Son of Man that sowed the seed. And also the field is the word. And what is the treasure? I mean, it could not be Christ. It could not be the gospel. Because Christ and the gospel are not hidden to this world. In fact, to the contrary, this world is not a friend of Jesus Christ, you see. So how can they hide him, you see? And then Jesus Christ once said, you put it in this way, Jesus Christ is not for sale, the gospel is not for sale. Me and you today, we can never buy the field. We don't have access to buy the field. Why? Because why? We are sinners, been bankrupt, you see? And also the salvation is a free gift from God. How can we buy it? We bankrupt sinners, you see? So how can we buy something? It is obvious, you see? So that was not the right interpretation, you see? That is the normal interpretation of this, you see? So the gospel is not for sale. Jesus Christ is not for sale. And for us to get the key understanding to all this parable that Jesus Christ gave, you have to listen to what Jesus Christ was speaking to his disciples in spirit. And he said that it's been given to you to know the secret of the kingdom of heaven, but to them it has not been given. And that is the first part of these parables in the book of Matthew chapter 13, verse 11. You remember that these seven parables, I mean that if you read from the first part of it, you find out sometimes it's very discouraging. For example, the first part of it, if you remember the parable about the stubborn soil, the stony soil, the torn soil, and the evil bed, and all those and all of that, you see, it's kind of negative parable, you see. But then again, you have to find out why it's so negative, because why? The Bible says some seed fell on the stony ground, and some seed fell on the tongue. In all these things, the man was sowing the seed, and that man is our Lord Jesus Christ today. The Son of Man was sowing the seed, and he was sowing that seed. The Bible says he was sending with a lavish hand. He was throwing the seed because he doesn't know which one is going to grow. You see? And we know what happened in that parable. But I also want to go on to another one as well. One of the second parable, he also said, yes, about the wheat. He's talking about the sown wheat, which is God's good wheat. But then again, the devil come and do what? Sow the wrong seed. That's how you have today. Have the hypocrites are in the church. And also the next parable talk about the parable of the mustard seed. So this is a mustard tree which the bears go and do was steal away the seed. So this also tells us what the rise of what the first occult that we have here today. And then again, the next parable, you talk about the parable of the living. Where is the woman? Hide the linen in the loaf of the bread, and he spread the whole loaf. So what he's trying to tell me here is this. That speaks about the devil's handwork, you see. Tries to do what? To penetrate in the church of God today with what? Living of sin. So now today, you are going to find out today that the treasure that the Jesus Christ was talking about is nothing else but what? The nation of Israel. The treasure hidden in the field is the nation of Israel. The first point here is this. Israel is a treasure, sovereignly chosen. Israel is a treasure, sovereignly chosen. So I have a verse to back it up here today, man. I have scriptures to back it up. For example, if you read the book of Exodus, listen to it. Exodus chapter 19, verse 5. It says, now therefore, if you indeed obey my voice, that God speaking here, and keep my commandment, you shall be my treasure possession among all people, for the earth is mine. Hallelujah. So God calls the Israel his possession treasure. And then again in the book of Deuteronomy chapter 14 verse 2. For you are people holy to the Lord your God, and the Lord has chosen you to be the people for his treasure possession out of all the people who are on the face of the earth. So Israel is God's chosen treasure. God says, Israel, you are my possession treasure. If you also look into the book of Psalm 135 verse 4. For the Lord has chosen you, Jacob himself, Israel has known his own word, possession, treasure. You see? So God keep on saying that Israel is chosen. And not only that, Israel is a chosen word, treasure. You see? And there's nowhere, anywhere you can find in the Bible that you can recollect the place called United Kingdom. It's not been written in the Bible. But if you go from passages to passages, you will see that the Bible is being mentioned. Israelite is a word, is a peculiar treasure for Almighty God, you see. So today, if you picture the nation of Israel, right, you also picture the church in the last days as we are here now. Israel is a treasure and the church is the pearl, you see. So Israel is God's chosen nation, and Israel is also a treasure unto the Almighty God. So as Israel goes, the whole world goes, you see. And that's what I was telling you today. If you look into the Bible, you can never find the nation. There's no more any talk about United Kingdom. You see, but if you go over and over again, you can find out the Bible said that Israel is God's what? Peculiar treasure. You see, so the first point here is this. Israel is a treasure sovereignly chosen by God. So the second point here is this. Israel is a treasure suddenly covered in the field in this world. You see, when Jesus Christ came into this world, Israel for all the particular purposes was lost unto her origin plan. Because why? The purpose of the kingdom of God, his people, the disciples, they were the one do to the world to give out the gospel news. God wanted to use the nation of Israel right as a light to the world, but they fell suddenly. But then again, their faith became what? Our own profit today. You see, if you look into the kingdom that have come past before, Israel have been subjected to different kind of things. Israel also was subjected under the Rome authority, according to the Roman Empire. But then again, The temple itself was run over by the money exchangers. As a matter of fact, Jesus Christ called them the lost sheep of Israel. Remember when Jesus Christ said in the book of Matthew 15, verse 24, he answered, I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Remember that? So the lost sheep of what? Of Israel. So Israel was lost, you see? And Christ came to the world to find them. And not only that, to do what? To find you too, my dear friends, you see? So it's choosing treasure, also what? A treasure, do what? Covered, you see? So Israel is also a treasure, suddenly claimed. Now listen to it. He said it was chosen, it was covered, it was claimed. Now our Lord Jesus Christ came to this earth to do what? When Jesus Christ came to this earth, what did he do? That treasure that was hidden in the field, which is the field is the word, he uncovered it. When our Lord Jesus Christ came to this earth, for 3.5 years, he displayed the kingdom of what? The heaven. He said, I came for the lost sheep of house of Israel. He revealed the treasure in the book of Matthew chapter 12, verse 28. I turn about the crystallizing of our Lord Jesus Christ. He said, what? Why? Because they were accusing him for casting out demons. And they said, it's only the prince of Beelzebub will do what? Will cast out demons. And Jesus Christ said this to them in the book of Matthew 12, verse 28. But if it is by the Spirit of God that I cast out demons. Now watch this. He said, then the kingdom of God has come upon you. So there you have it. Our Lord Jesus Christ, the King of heaven, was in the midst of them. But they could not notice him. They refused him. They sprang at him. Why? Because they were spiritually blind to the reality of the things of heaven. And that's why they were saying he has a demon. But then again, you need to listen to this response in the book of Matthew 13, verse 13. So this is why he speaks to them in parables, okay? He said, because they're saying they do not see, hearing they do not hear, nor do they understand. Indeed, in their case, the prophecy of Isaiah is fulfilled that says, you are indeed here, but you never understand. You indeed see, but you never perceive. For the kingdom of God is uncovered. So here is what, there is a grace of hope. There is the king doing miracle in their midst. But for the fact they are spiritually blind, they did not see the reality. They did not see the kingdom of God. And the kingdom of God was buried again. And now Jesus Christ speaking to them in parables. Not only to do what? To reveal, but also to do what? To conceal. This is the first time Jesus Christ speaks in parables in the book of Matthew chapter 13. It is the first time. Why? Because he came to do what? To reveal the kingdom of God. That the kingdom of God was sprung. It was neglected. It was refused. It was lying on. And our Lord Jesus Christ choosing the treasure to uncover the treasure and then to cover it back again. But now Jesus Christ is going to do what? To reveal it. He revealed the treasure and cover it back up again. And then he went to do what? To redeem the treasure. He is the one who paid the price to buy the field. Amen. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 18. Chapter 1, verse 18 to 19. Knowing that you were ransomed from the fertile waste inherited from your forefathers, not with perishable things such as gold or silver, but with what? Precious blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, like that of the Lamb without blemish or spot. So Jesus Christ possessed the field with his precious blood. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. And that is why today, me and you today, we are the chosen treasure. Amen. Jesus Christ treasure you. Jesus Christ treasure you. Jesus Christ treasure me. Because the Bible says in the book of Luke chapter 19 verse 22, that God came to do what in this life? To seek you and to save you. You see, if it was becoming about money, Jesus Christ could have come as a banker. If it was about the peace treaty, he could have come as a diplomat. If it was about housing, he could have come as a house developer. If all these things, but he came purposely for one reason, to do what? To save the lost souls, you see? So here is our Lord Jesus Christ revealed the treasure. Not only that, redeemed the treasure. Not only that, reclaimed the treasure. So the Lord Jesus Christ is coming back to this earth. Do you know this? He has bought Israelite with his own blood. When I mention Israelite, add yourself there, my dear friends, you see? The treasure that was redeemed, he bought the field in order to do what? To return for the treasure. And now here is the point. I want you to get this into your heart, into your mind, that God is not finished with the nation of Israel. I want to also give you some special verses for it. In the book of Matthew chapter 23, verse 37 to 39, Jesus Christ is coming down from the mountain of Olives, going to the eastern gate. with what where he wept once before. And the Bible says this, that just quite he said, "Oh Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the city that kills the prophet and stones those who are sent to it. How often I have gathered your children together as a hen gathers the brood under her wings, and you were not willing. See, your house is left desolate." So that is the treasure covered. But watch this, "For I tell you, you will not see me again until you say, 'Blessed is the one who comes in the name of our Lord.'" Amen. So friend, one day the scale will fall from the eyes of Israel, right? And then we fall from their eyes. And you see that Apostle Paul says that the same thing happened to Apostle Paul. And when he was going to do what, to persecute our Lord Jesus Christ, the Bible said that light shone on him. He was blind for 3 days, and then again his eyes opened. The scale fell from his eyes. You see, listen to the book of Romans chapter 11 verse 25 to 29, and he says, "I do not want you to be ignorant of this mystery." So remember this, he's talking about the mystery, okay? And the mystery of what? Of the buried treasure. "That you should not be ignorant of this mystery, lest you become wise in your own sight, that the blindness in the part has do what? Happened to Israel, and that is the treasure uncovered until the fullness of the Gentiles have come in." So now, in this way, Israelites will be saved. As it is written, "The deliverer will come from Zion and will banish the ungodly from Jacob." So when the Bible talks about Jacob, it's talking about the name of Jacob is what? It's the fleshy Jacob, you see, because he didn't call them Israel this time. And then he said, "You will become the covenant with them when I take away their sins. As regard to the gospel, they are the enemy for your sake." And that is the turn away from the gospel. So you Gentiles, God said, because why? The children of Israelites move away from God. That's why today, we the Gentiles, we got saved today. You see, what a wonderful thing. Something that was bad, God told it to do what? To be good. You see? And then again, it says here, "For the grace to the election, that they are beloved for the sake of their forefathers, for the gift of God and the calling of God are irrevocable." Amen? The Bible says his gift and his calling, his election is what? Irrevocable, you see? So when God never changes his mind, like some of you today change your mind, some of us will change our mind, but God never changes his mind. You see, when God makes a solemn promise, the Bible says his gift and his calling of God is without repentance. So God says he's coming back for his treasure. So let me give you another verse concerning this, that God's choosing a solemn promise to Israelites in the book of Psalm 89, verse 27 to 37. He's speaking here of David. He says, verse 27, "And I will make him the firstborn and the highest of the kings of the earth. My steadfast love will keep him forever, and my covenant will stand firm for him. I will establish his offspring forever, and his throne as the dead of the heaven. If the children forsake my law," and I say that they have, "and they do not keep according to my rules," and I say they do not keep it, "if they violate my statutes," I said, "I have already done it. I do not keep my commandment," I said, "they didn't even keep it, then I will punish their transgression with the rod and their iniquity with scribes. And God have done this, but now watch this. But I will not remove from him my steadfast love or to be forced to my faithfulness." That's God we are serving. When we do something wrong, God still loves us, my dear friends. You see? When we do something wrong, God still loves us, because the Bible says he will never remove his steadfast love. You see, our God is a faithful God. "I will not violate my covenant or utter the word that went forth from my lips. Once for all I have sworn by my holiness, I will not lie to David." This is God telling you today. No matter how in our shortcoming, the Bible says God loves you. Our God is a faithful God. When we are unfaithful, the Bible says God is faithful. Why? Because the Bible says God never changes, you see? And then it says this, "Like the moon, it shall be established forever as a faithful witness in the skies." And then he says, Sarah. So that means what? Think about it, meditate on it, you see? So here is God's prophecy that the Jewish people will be, even though whether they're disobedient, whether they're discredited, whether everything that happens in their life, the Bible says still love them. But now, he said destroy. You remember the king of Egypt couldn't destroy the children of Israelite. The Red Sea could not even bring them down. The famine could not devour Israel. The gallows of Ham could not even hang Israel. Remember Esther? And then the nations of the world have tried to do what? To eliminate Israel. But the Bible says in everything, Israel are God's chosen people, you see. So God prophesies that in the last day, that he is going to bring Israel back. And we know in May 1948 that Israel became a nation again. Israel was born again for one day after 18 centuries, you see. So now today, the Israelites are back again in their land, speaking the same kind of Hebrew that Amos preached and prophesied, that one day Israel of Israel are going to come back again. So we see that all the people that came before us, talking about the Amorites, the Jebusites. Do any of you hear them speaking about Jebusites, Amorites, and Moabites anymore? No, but you can go to Israel today. You can hear them speaking the same Jew that the people in the past spoke, you see? So Israel has suffered unspeakable atrocities, even under the persecution of the Pharaoh, under the persecution of Nebuchadnezzar, under the Alexander the Great, under Nero, under the Turks, under the Hitler, under the Russian, and also so-called lukewarm Christians, you see. May God have mercy upon us today, you see. And then again today, under the Arab nations as well, you see. But let me tell you something. Israel is God's treasure. Christ came, and first of all, he says what? This is what? He came to do what? To save the lost soul of Israel, the house of Israel, you see. So the treasure is uncovered, and then the treasure is possessed by our Lord Jesus Christ today, with his precious blood. Jesus Christ is coming back again. He's going to do what? To redeem his treasure, you see. So today, nobody can destroy the Jewish people. Nobody can destroy the nation of Israel. Why? Because God is with them. God is with Israel. He can try everything. The Bible says, if he bless them, you get blessed. If he curse them, you be cursed. You see, especially today, because of the children of Israel right today. That's why God come in this life, to save everyone. He said he came to do what? To seek and to save the lost soul of house of Israel. And today, you are included today, my dear friend, you see. Today, when I mention Israel, I want you to add yourself, especially belong to Israel, you see, because they are God's chosen people. God said, this the people that I love, and I want to use them to do what? To spread the good news all over the world today. So their downfall became a blessing for me and for you today. Listen to what the Bible says. I give another verse in the book of Jeremiah. Jeremiah chapter 5, 31, verse 35 to 37. Listen to it. That says the Lord, who give the sun for the light by day, and feeds the other of the moon, and the stars by light by night, and stir up the sea so that it waves and roar. The Lord of the hosts is his name. So listen to this. He said he feeds the other. So which other that he's talking about? He's talking about he feeds the sun, he feeds the moon, he feeds the star. And the Bible says he feeds them in order. And then whenever they depart from him, declares the Lord, they shall do what? Offspring of Israel says, from the nation of Israel before me forever. That says the Lord. So if the heavens is above, can be measured. So he's saying here today, can you measure the heaven? Can you measure how high the heaven is? That's what God is asking. And he said the foundation of the earth below can be explored. He said, yeah, can you find something that is holding, that the earth is resting on? And then he says, then I will cast out the offspring of Israel for all they have done, declares the Lord. So what God is saying here is this. How can you cast the children of Israel? He said that the only way he can do that today, if you try to cast the children of Israel today, you, my dear friends, he said today, can you pull down the sun? Can you put down the moon? Can you put down the stars? And can you tell God how high is the heaven? Can you also show to God that what is the earth is resting on? He said, God says he will do what? He will keep his word to Israel. Israel is his treasure. Israel is his territory to the faithfulness of our God. And Jesus Christ is coming back for his own word, his own possession, treasure. He came the first time to do what? To undo it, and he shed his precious blood, and because of his precious blood, he obtained that treasure. And that treasure today is your heart, my dear friend. That treasure today is my heart today. That's why when Jesus Christ says, where your heart is where your treasure will be. That everything else that you are looking for today in this life today, the Bible said that they will rust, they will mold, and they will pass away. But the word of God will remain the same, my dear friend. God bless you, man. Amen. God. God bless you. You see a crown on my head? God bless you, man. God bless you. Jesus loves you, man. Yes. Thank you, man. Thank you, man. God bless you. Thank you, man. Thank you, man. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Because that's when you talk, the anointing.
Amen.
Comes.
Amen.
So stay strong.
Thank you.
It's not your strength.
Thank you.
Even when you are here, it's not you.
Amen.
It's the Holy Spirit of God.
Yeah.
Who you are. It's all part of
you. Amen, man.
God needs human beings. That's why from a Muslim background, he called me out.
Amen. God bless you, man.
He told me to go and encourage his remnants.
Amen.
The black
race. Amen.
That's why they're after the black race, it was a satanic war.
Yeah.
But God is going to use the black race, and the black race, their presence in this nation, make him, he took me to Abraham, not to do what he wants to do.
Amen.
Please know this little fix the matter.
Amen.
Because they make it come out with joy.
Amen.
And the Lord said he sustains
his people.
Yeah?
Amen.
Don't worry how you see somebody else with so much, but you know how he gets it.
Yeah.
God's ways.
Amen.
What you are doing, God is happy about it.
Amen.
Keep saying, well done.
Thank you, man. So, God bless you, man.
Bless.
More grace to you, man. Amen. Thank you, man. Hallelujah. So I'm saying today, so the treasure today has been uncovered and been purchased by the precious blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. So my dear friends, today, time is coming. My heart hangs for God to come. As every believer today, we are waiting for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Revelation chapter 22 verse 20 says, come Lord Jesus. Come Jesus, come. You see? So Zechariah says this in Zechariah 13 verse 1. He said, on the day shall be a fountain open for the house of David and the inhabitants of Jerusalem to cleanse them from sin and uncleanness. So there is a fountain filled with blood. And draw from the veins of our Lord Jesus Christ to them. And then Zechariah chapter 13 verse 9 says, I will put this thought into the fire and refine them as one refined silver, and test them as gold is tested, and they shall call upon my name, and I will answer them. I will say, they are my people, and they will say, the Lord is my God. Amen. Amen. So Jesus Christ is coming, my dear friends, today. So Jesus Christ said that he has chosen us today as his treasure. And what does that have to do with you? Number one, I want you to tell you that Jesus Christ is being scheduled on time. Amen. When he's coming, I don't know. You don't know. None of us know. Jesus Christ doesn't even know when he's coming. But God the Father knows. So today, you have been satisfied. You have been cleansed with the precious blood of our Lord Jesus Christ today. And the second point here is this. If God kept his word to Abraham, the same God also can keep his word to me and for you today. And the third thing I want you to see is this. To believe that we are in the last day. Why? Because why? Christ could step out of the glory and to do what? To uncover his treasure. Now the point here is this. Is your treasure clean? Your treasure is your heart. Is your heart clean? Because the Bible says in the book of Matthew chapter 5, it says only those with their heart clean can see God today. So today, my dear friend, if you haven't given your life to Jesus Christ today, let me do it in prayer. Can you ask Jesus Christ to come inside your heart? Say, Jesus Christ, that I'm a sinner, that I believe in you, that he came and died for me, and with your precious blood that you have cleansed me, I want to be saved, and that in his name, that you believe that he came in the flesh and died and rose again on the third day, and you confess that he's your Lord today. My dear friends, today you will be saved. Is that easy? Yes, is that easy? You can be saved. You see, it doesn't matter what you've done in the past. Your past remains in past tense. God do not remember your past anymore. When he see the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ over your life, you have been covered. Remain blessed in the mighty name of Jesus. Jesus is Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen and amen and amen.